Actually, if you are a young man who hopes to get married someday, this is perfect for you, because it was actually written for a young man who was wanting to get married, and his mom gave him basically some instructions of what to look for. For you ladies in the room who aren't a mom because of maybe your own choice or maybe not your own choice, I recognize that you're in the room, and this word is for you as well. This scripture can just be about being a great lady, about being a great woman of God, about influencing whoever is around you. Mom, I don't know if this is how you feel, but I saw this quote yesterday and thought this was kind of funny. Everybody wants to save the world, do kinds of great things, you know, they want to accomplish mighty things in their life, but nobody wants to help me with the dishes. Is that you sometimes, Mom? You feel maybe that's a little bit of you? Or this one, I wasn't sure exactly how this relationship went, but I saw this quote. For Mother's Day, I got my mom a case of Bud Light. After all, I'm the reason she drinks. I guess he was a little trouble. I'm assuming it was a he, but that's just an assumption. Today, we focus on being a woman of God, and men. As I said, this was really written for a man to choose his wife. But if you're already married, I don't want you to use this, men, as a big stick to clobber your wife over the head of things she's not doing well. I want you to use this as a way to just lift up the things she is doing well and encourage her. It says in verse 1, the king says of King, the sayings of King Lemuel, an inspired utterance his mother taught him. So this is a mom's teaching to her young son who's going to be a king of what kind of queen he should look for, what kind of wife he should look for. That's really the backbone to this Proverbs 31. And we don't see this in the English, but from 10 to 31, as I read to you, there's 22 verses there, and in the Hebrew alphabet, there's 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. And if we would know Hebrew and read it in the Hebrew, each verse starts with one of those letters. So this is really an acrostic that the Hebrew children, boys, young men would have memorized as a passage to refer to as they were seeking out their wife for the rest of their life, and to encourage their wife in what it means to be a godly woman. Let's look at verse 10. It says, a wife of noble character, who can find? She's worth far more than rubies. Now, for us today, we would probably prefer diamonds in there, because that's what we give our wives. But a ruby is actually quite a beautiful gem, red, and it's very, very valuable. She's a wife of noble character, is worth far more than rubies. We're going to look at six characteristics that this scripture passage teaches about being a wife of noble character. First, she has character as a wife. She's one of character. Verse 11, her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. So when this would have been written, the men often had multiple wives. I don't suggest that to any of you men, besides it's against law. It wasn't good. And so the relationship between the man and his wife or wives wasn't very good. There was a lot of competition. There was a lot of jealousy. There was a lot of lack of trust and confidence, to the point that the Jewish men would lock up their stuff if they were going to be gone for a few days because they didn't trust their wife or wives. but not a Proverbs 31 wife. He has full confidence in her. She lacks nothing of value. They have an amazing, trusting relationship. They can lean on each other. They trust each other. They support each other. They lift each other up. Nobody's doing anything behind each other's back. They fully trust each other. Verse 12 goes on. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. She's affirming him. She's doing things that encourage him. She's not doing things deceptive behind his back. And then down in verse 23, it says, her husband is respected at the city gate, where he takes his seat among the elders of the land. Part of the reason I think he's respected is because he has a wife that's respected. He has a wife of character. He has a wife that he doesn't have to keep explaining away why she does this or why she does that. He has a wife that he can be proud of, and so it lifts him up as well, and so he is respected in the community. Sean, what do you think? 2016. What does it look like to be a woman of character?
Well, when we talked about this, the person that came to mind was a friend of mine, Melissa. Her husband is a piano player in a piano bar, and actually he owns the piano bar, so that consumes his life. And she's a mom, and she's involved in her kids' lives and, you know, helps the Girl Scouts and with Boy Scouts and all those things. And she has her own cupcake business out of her house. So she's making cupcakes for people's weddings and things like that. And he calls her up one day and says, hey, I want to throw this party for the bartender on Friday. It was Wednesday. And can you throw together something for him? We want to have the party for the staff before we open on Friday night. And you know she had to do some significant amount of rearranging in her life to be able to pull this off. But she shows up on Friday with a cake shaped like a guitar and a bunch of cupcakes all around it to celebrate this guy's birthday. You know, her husband has full confidence in her. He knew he could call her. He knew that she would have his back. And she didn't grumble and complain and say, oh, this is horrible. She just did some rearranging and made it happen. And that's just a beautiful picture to me of how that looks in her life. So for us, well, I'm not really going to make cupcakes, but I'll have your favorite frozen pizza on hand.
Oh, yes. All right.
I'll try.
A woman of good character. Number two, she has devotion to her household. She's committed to what's going on at home. She's taking care of what's going on at home. And this is not exactly maybe what you're thinking of or the first things that pop into your head. Let's look at what Proverbs says. Verse 13, she selects wool and flax and works with eager hands. She's making stuff to sell, we're going to learn later on. I'm not telling you ladies you all need to go home and make your kids' clothes or your husband's clothes from scratch. They probably wouldn't like that so much anyway. She's making thread, she's making cloth out of wool, and she's making linen out of flax. Verse 14, she's like the merchant ships bringing her food from afar. She's taking care of her household. She's going to the grocery store, but to go to the store with good deals or with the best food, she might be going some distance. And during that time, she's walking. She's walking a long distance to go and get what is best. Verse 15, she gets up while it is still night. So she's getting up early and taking care of her household, doing what needs to be done. She provides food for her family and portion for her female servants. So remember, this is a queen that this chapter is talking about. So she's got some female servants. And this word portion here means more duties than like a portion of food. So she's handing out the duties to the ladies, to the servants in the castle. She's taking care of the household. She's the manager, as I jokingly labeled Sean a few years back, the home manager. And that's exactly what she's doing. Verse 16, she considers a field and buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. Out of her earnings, Isn't this interesting? She buys a field. She's helping to support the family. Verse 24 helps us know more specifically how she's doing this. Verse 24, she makes linen garments and she sells them and supplies the merchants with sashes. So it's the first home-based business, or first businesswoman. She's contributing to the family so much that she's got her own earnings. She's buying her own field. She's planting her own vineyard, and she's helping to support the family. Verse 17, she sets about her work vigorously, and her arms are strong for her tasks. Now, ladies, you could use this verse as an excuse to go to the Y every day and pump some iron. But I don't think that's what this verse is talking about. I think she has strong arms because she works vigorously, because she's a hard worker, and she's taking care of her family, and she's helping to support the family. Verse 18, she sees that her trading is profitable and her lamp does not go out late. So we heard earlier, she's getting up early, helping to make the food and give out duties, and she's staying up late. Her lamp does not go out at night, and she's taking care of the home. She's an important part of the family system and the family machine that works. And she's not sitting on the couch. She's an important part of managing the family. Sean, what does it look like in 2016 to be a devoted woman to her household?
That's quite a list. I can get up early, but I can't get up early and stay up late. So I don't know. I've got a ways to go. I think the thing I walk away with from all of these things, really, is that it's about time management and money management, that she's good at managing her time, and she's good at managing her money. So, you know, today that means we're not spending more than we're bringing in, and we're throwing 31 parties or whatever, right, the home-based businesses that we're involved in. We're using our Kohl's cash well. I think it just means being wise with our money and wise with our time. It's a good balance.
So then number three, she's generous to the needy. So all of this money she's bringing in, all this work that she's doing is not so she can get a better Lexus or so she can get her nails done 3 times a month. She's providing for the needy. Verse 20, she opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. She's outward focused. She cares about those around her who have need, and she's generous with them. Number four, she is influential as a teacher. If you created your own list of what it looked like to be a godly woman, or a godly mother, or a godly wife, this would probably not make the list. But it's in there. Look at verse 25. She's clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She has dignity. She has strength. She's influential in her community. And she can laugh at the days to come because she knows who holds the days to come. She knows that God is in control. She's done what she can to care for those around her and manage the things for her future. But she laughs at the days to come because she's done everything she can and she knows who holds it. As I thought about an influential woman, we had the funeral for Lois Haywish this Thursday. That was an influential woman, 84 years old, and the church was pretty full. Her children, her grandchildren, her great-grandchildren, and so many people from the community spoke so highly of Lois and her influence on their life and her care, her desire to serve others. It was a beautiful picture. Verse 26 speaks about this even more strongly. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. So where's she getting this wisdom? From the Word of God. She's studying the Word of God. She's spending time in the Word of God, and it's just flowing right out of her. And so she has something faithful to share. She has instruction to share with those around her. Sean, what do you think about being an influential teacher?
Well, when I think of that, the person who came to mind was someone who influenced me. We were at a bumpy point in our marriage, a place where there are some bumps along the way, and this friend invited me into her home and into her life and shared with me and really helped me learn and grow and influenced our marriage. And so I think of her as someone who is influential and a teacher in my life, and yet she wasn't really a teacher. She was just a friend. And so I share that with you to say that you might not think of yourself as influential or a teacher. You might go, well, that is not me at all. And for all of us in this room, God has put us in places where we are in circles of friendships and relationships, maybe at work or just in your neighborhood, or friends that you get together with for a book club or whatever. Those relationships, those circles, those are places where God has placed you. And you might not even realize that you have influence there by being a friend, by being caring, by being concerned. And so I would just encourage you to be aware of that, to maybe pray that God will open your eyes to how he's called you to be influential and come alongside of someone who has needs, or celebrate with someone who's celebrating, and maybe share with them a little bit about who Jesus is.
Number five, she's intentional with her family relationships. Verse 27, she watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. So she's not sitting on the couch playing on her iPad or watching the soap opera when the kids are fighting in the other room. She's managing the household. She's taking care of the relationships. She sees the relationships as her priority. And then verse 28, this is kind of the key passage that people like to pull out of Proverbs 31. Her children arise and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. So as you seek after these things, there's going to be good fruit. Your children are more likely to call you blessed, to affirm you, to encourage you. And you're going to see good fruit in their own life. And then eventually you're going to see good fruit in their children's life as you pour godly characteristics in them. And, you know, as a husband, husbands love to affirm their wives and encourage their wives. And so we seek to do that. And it's easy as you seek to be a Proverbs 31 kind of woman. But we don't do it perfectly. None of us do it perfectly as husbands. Nobody does it perfectly as a wife. But it's something we seek after to live up to. Sean, tell me more about being intentional with relationships in the household.
Well, I think recently, about a month ago, someone said to me that relationships are built on small talk. And that was really a great perspective for me, a little bit of a shift in perspective. And I just thought about all the small ways that we build relationships. And those little things that we're doing, those little conversations that moms were having with our kids, wives were having with our husbands, those things build our relationship. In our family, the driver gets to pick the music in the car. And I started that rule a long time ago when my kids were little and they wanted to listen to like Barney songs all the time. Oh, well, I'd love to, but the driver gets to pick the music, and so we're just going to have some variety here and not listen to those all the time. Well, now my daughter Sarah is 16 and she is driving, and I cannot drive.
Because of her seizure.
Because I had a seizure, so the state of Wisconsin doesn't want me to drive for a while. And so Sarai is driving our family all around. She is now the primary driver, the chauffeur of our family. And the driver gets to pick the music. So I am learning a lot of really new songs to me. And in fact, the other night, 90s at 9 came on, and I was like, oh, 90s at 9, and Sarah pressed the button and turned to another channel because she likes the tunes that are not from the 90s, from today. So we're driving along, and this song comes on, and I was like, oh, I know that song. It's My House by Flo. And Sarah was like, oh, my goodness, I can't believe you know it. She was so impressed. Yeah. And I didn't tell her right away. There's that digital readout on our radio that tells you what song it is. So I really just read it. I really didn't know the song by heart. But those kinds of moments are moments that we share and that build our relationship, right? Little things that happen when you're in the car and when you're doing things together in your yard or in your house. Those are little things that build the relationships that we have with each other. So take advantage of the small talk. Take advantage of the small things. Today's Mother's Day. I'm wearing every fake diamond Caleb has ever gotten for me. Because I want him to know I appreciate him, and I'm so thankful that he appreciates me. So small talk, small ways to build relationships.
Number 6, she is excellent as a woman after God. Verse 30, charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Women, I think there's a lot of competition in our world, and it's mostly focused on, in your world, unfortunately, on beauty. It's really sadly, our culture perpetuates a huge focus on beauty, and God's word says beauty is fleeting. It's not important. It's not the number one thing. There is so much something attractive for a woman who's after God. A woman who's seeking God, a woman who prays for her husband, a woman who prays for her children, a woman who seeks after the Lord and fears the Lord. That is so much more attractive than having your hair done the perfect way or the perfect dress or the perfect weight. A woman who fears the Lord is something excellent and something beautiful, something that's as precious, more precious than a ruby, more precious than any diamond we could ever buy for you, more precious than any jewelry we're ever going to be able to afford. You are precious in God's eyes, and we hope you know that and feel that this day on Mother's Day. Sean, any closing words for them?
Well, when Chad first asked me if I would share some stories during the sermon, I was like, no. I will not do that. There are a lot of reasons that I didn't really want to do this, but one of them is because I never really liked Proverbs 31. I always felt like it was a checklist, and when I read it, I didn't really measure up. And I want to encourage you, ladies, that if you look at this and you feel like today you're walking away going, these are some things I have not done very well, that you look at that last closing section, because it is really about you and the Lord. And He loves you. He loves you so much. He not only gave His life for you. He loves you more than rubies. And so the Proverbs 31 woman, while it's a beautiful picture and definitely something young men you should be thinking about as a wife, no, it's not about measuring up to the list. It's about fearing the Lord and walking faithfully with Him, because He has grace to cover everything that we fall short, every way we fall short. His forgiveness never ends. And He loves you more than rubies.
Let's pray. Lord, thanks so much for your love for us, for your mercy for us. Thank you for giving us this chapter in your word as men to encourage our wives or choose a future wife. Thank you for this guidance for women and what it looks like to be a godly wife, mother, and a woman of God. Lord, we lift up today moms, that they would be encouraged, that they would know they're loved by you. Pray for every woman in the room, that they would see themselves as valuable, more precious than a ruby, more precious than a diamond, that they are beautiful in your sight, that they are loved and they are treasured and they have forgiveness from you for their imperfections, and they have the peace and love that surpasses understanding because of you. And so we give you thanks, Lord, for the moms in the room, and we give them this day in your name.